robust solution for the decision maker in terms of the trade-offs between support area and staircase effect. The results for a perturbation delta of 2 in the angles was found that the solution D has the best support area and is a robust solution for a perturbation level of delta equal 2. Solution C has the best value of staircase effect, also robust for delta equal 1. And solution E is a trade-off solution between the two objectives. In the discussion of the results, an analysis of the robust solutions obtained in a multi-objective approach is performed in terms of the quality measures, support area and staircase effect, as can be seen in this table. It was observed that solution A is robust for delta equal 1, but becomes non-robust for delta equal 2. Solution D is different from the solution A, meaning that solution A is robust for delta equal 1, but becomes non-robust for delta equal 2. Solution C is robust and the best in terms of staircase effect. And solutions B and E are intermediate alternative for the decision maker in terms of staircase effect and support area. For conclude, the build orientation optimization of 3D parts is one of the crucial factors to obtain the best final quality of the part surface. A robust multi-objective optimization in the build orientation problem was presented, minimizing the staircase effect and support area. The rear panel fixed model was used. The experiments were conducted for two perturbation values, delta equal 1 and delta equal 2. The objective function values that are sensitive to perturbations in the orientation angles were analyzed. Small perturbations in theta x represents a large effect in the staircase effect function. And the robust solutions will help the decision makers to identify the best build orientation according to his or her preferences. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Any questions? I don't see any questions. I have a couple of questions. First of all, congratulations on your work and your presentation. And the first question is the robustness and the robust approach a common approach in this type of works? And the second question is related to the first. There are other types of robust approach, like the worst case scenario or using regret. Do you think this type of approach could be applied instead of the mean effective objective function approach that you used?
Yes, is a common robust multi-objective approach, and exist others, but we choose this technique for to resolve this problem.
Okay. Eligius is giving some hints and good suggestions to improve the work. Any other questions? Okay, thank you again, Marina, for your excellent work.
Thank you.
And we move to the second presentation that will be given by Philippe Monera. Philippe, the floor is yours.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm not sure. I think.
Yes, we can see it.
Okay. Good morning again. Our work is about a modeling and a decomposition approach in a resource assignment problem for fleet management, considering outsourcing. Joined to this work are the Professor Joana Dias and Maria João Alves, both of University of Coimbra. This work addresses a fleet management problem where vehicles and drivers must be assigned to working trips that have to take in place in predetermined time periods. These trips have also predetermined routes, so a routing optimization does not need to be considered. The objective is to determine the resource assignment, minimizing total cost. One of the challenge of this problem is the fact that the assignment of drivers and vehicles cannot be done independently of each other. The number of vehicles needed depends on the vehicle availability and on the number of passengers that will travel. The number of drivers depends not only on the number of vehicles assigned, but also on the trip's characteristics. In a previous work, a similar fleet management resource assignment problem was already being tackled. However, only internal resources were considered, which does not fully illustrate in the situation in most institutions. We consider the possibility of both internal and external resources being used, making explicit the possibility of resorting to outsourcing whenever that is needed or it's beneficial in terms of cost minimization. Furthermore, we also propose a decomposition method for the calculation of solutions that takes advantage of the characteristics of this problem, but then that can also be applied to other problems with similar structures. This decomposition method leads to an optimal solution of the problem, provided that the sub-problems are solved to optimality. Several data sets were created with different characteristics aiming to access the solutions calculated for developed model and the behavior of the decomposition optimization algorithm proposed. This approach is compared with the use of a general solver for the entire model without decomposition. The model considers the simultaneous assignment of vehicles and drivers to travel requests, as well the possibility of having trips with no internal resource assignment and resorting to outsourcing. For these question requisitions, the number of passengers, the destination, and the schedule are predefined. The number of drivers that must be considered for every vehicle used is also known. This model follows closely the one described in the previous work, except for the outsourcing modeling that is new in this model presented herein. Objective function guarantees the minimization of total cost, taking advantage of the ordering of the trips by increasing cost. It is possible to assure an adequate accounting of the proper costs to consider whenever there are shared resources between different trips. The first three terms concern respectively vehicle, driver, and outsourcing cost. The last term is a perturbation term with epsilon, a positive, very small number, which aims to avoid unnecessary sharing in case of alternative optimal solution. Constraints ensure in addition to consistency between the decision variables, the availability and the number of seats, the possibility of sharing resources if there is compatibility and overlap, the number of drivers required for each trip, the use of a higher cost on compatibility travel, the non-allocation of resources if the choice is outsourcing. The first attempt made to calculate the optimal solution, for instance, considering the described model, used a general solver, CPLEX. CPLEX is capable of significantly reducing the number of variables in pre-processing stage by a priori fixing some of these variables. The optimality gaps obtained were large and the computational times were also significant. The main idea was to take advantage of this time that implicitly exists in the data and that allow us to understand whether trips can be compatible and can share resources or they not have any intersections considering the realization time period. If it's possible to determine disjoint sets such that no trip in onset has any time intersection with any other trip in the other set, then it's possible to decompose the original instance into a smaller instance that can be easy to solve using a general solver. The subproblems are defined by the same model presented, but considering the set of trips that belong to corresponding subset, it's possible to calculate a solution to the original instance and the corresponding value for the objective function by considering all the optimal values for the decision variables. The global objective function value can be calculated by the sum of all subproblems' objective function values. If some or all subproblems are not solved to optimality, it's possible to calculate the maximal optimality gap. This decomposition is made in an automatic and iterative way, trying to balance as much as possible the number of trips that are placed in each set. This can be done by resorting the resolution of an auxiliary linear interprogram problem that takes only seconds to solve. The procedure is repeated for every subset found until it's not possible to subdivide the sets anymore, or the number of trips in each set is already very small. It is possible to end up with a decomposition tree of the problem instance. The figure shows an example for the decomposition tree for the generated instance, one of the generated instance. The instance were generated having a start point, the case study describing in previous work. From this original set, two groups with total of 40 instances each were then created. The first group contains 20 instances and considers a vehicle fleet equal to the set of the base instance. The second group also contains 20 instances but considers a vehicle fleet composed by 16 vehicles of lower capacity only, up to 5 passengers. Within each group, some of data were randomly generated to test the decomposition problem with different trips, compatibility, and non-overlapping characteristics, but always guaranteeing the coherence of the data. Instances with each group were built with an increased number of trips overlapping. This means that instances identified as A present less time overlapping than the other instances of the same group, and this overlapping increase from A to T. The compatibility between two trips depends both on the time compatibility and the spatial compatibility, that is, destinations. Increasing time overlapping from A to T increase the possibility of compatibility between trips, but decrease the degree of decomposition by the DP approach. Instances built in this way allow assessing the impact of trip compatibility in sharing of resources and the use of outsourcing, random data generation associated with each instance is shown in the article. Considering the instance for group one, both Seplex and the decomposition approach were able to find the optimal solution in only three instances out of 20. It is possible to conclude that both methods have increased difficulties in solving the problems as the time overlapping increase, presenting successively large gaps. It was not possible to find the optimal solution, for instance, belonging to group two, within the computational time limits defined. The same pattern of having an increased gap with an increased time overlapping of the trips is also observed, but the gap obtained are lower than the ones obtained for group one. Both groups, the decomposition method was able to find better solutions than Seplex in most of the instances, and it was able to produce better bounds of solution with gaps different of from zero. However, the decomposition approach still leads to solution with a significant optimality gap in instance where trips have a large overlapping. Analyzing the obtained solutions, it's possible to classify the assignment of resources to trips into three different classes: trips that share resource, trips that not share resource, and the ones that are outsourced. Outsourcing shows a trend of increasing with the increase of compatibility and time overlapping between trips. This increase in the compatibility and time overlapping can have two distinct consequences. Until a certain point, it will promote resource sharing. However, beyond a certain level, there are too many trips taking place at the same time, and there are not enough resources to be able to with all the trips. Instances in group two are characterized by having a homogeneous fleet of small vehicles. In this setting, it is necessary to resort to outsourcing much more frequently. On average, 29% of trips are outsourced, being a larger percentage equal to 48%. As the number of available sets per vehicle is small, they use the shared resources limited even when there are compatibility trips. It's more often used when all the compatibility trips have a lower number of passengers. If this number increases, then they use of more on vehicles to assure the needed capacity turnouts to be more expensive than outsourcing the trip. While it's not possible to compare this solution with solutions manually defined by the people in charge of this assignment, since some of the data have been randomly generated, where have already concluded in other work that the use of this type of model leads to better solutions than the ones that are manually created for case in which outsourcing was not considered. Adding an extra degree of freedom, outsourcing, makes this problem even harder to solve manually. So we believe this is a valuable tool for organizations that have to deal with similar situations. This work presents a model and algorithm approach for extension of the generalizing assignment problem. The problem of assigning two distinct resources to a set of tasks, where the assignment of one resource is dependent on the assignment of the other. If the tasks are compatible, they can share resources. The model also includes the possibility of outsourcing. This work was motivated by the identification of an existing decision-making problem in a public university, Brazilian university. This problem is NP-hard, and it has proved to be very difficult to solve by using a general solver. This motivated development of a dedicated approach based on the composition of the problem. The decomposition approach was able to calculate for most of instances better solutions with lower gaps. Also, the gaps obtained, for instance, with height overlapping between trips are still considerable. It is possible to conclude that the use of this model and the algorithm approach can efficiently automate the decision-making process. It enables to reach solutions that are better than the solutions calculated manually, promoting greater sharing of resources. Thank you.
Thank you, Philip. We are just in time for a very quick question. Elysius have typed a question. And also congratulating you. And actually, it's more an idea, a good idea, than a question of your work. I have a question. You mentioned that you use data from real world problem for your previous work, and yeah. In this work you reuse some part of that data. Is that data coming from Portugal or from Brazil?
From Brazil. I worked at the Universidade Federal de Viçosa in Brazil, and I work with this data when I was there.
Okay. Well, congratulations again. Very nice work.
Thank you.
And very good presentation. So we must move on to the next presentation, which will be given by Telmo Pinto. And Telmo, the floor is yours.
Go ahead. Thank you so much. Good morning all again. I would like to let me share my presentation. Could you see?
Yes.
Okay. So good morning again. I would like to present the real problem, real vehicle routing problem that we have in a Portuguese company. We have a real multi-compartment and multi-trip vehicle routing problem with time windows in a Portuguese company for full, which is a full retailer. And our approach here is to develop a two-stage heuristic. But in the conclusion, we'll see that perhaps the future work will lead us to solutions that are not heuristic. But let's start from the beginning. I will try to introduce this problem and the case study in this Portuguese company. How do we tackle this problem, and finally present the results and draw some conclusions. Well, the VRP problem, the vehicle routing problem, is a well-known problem where we have a set of customers to be visited or served by a fleet. Our objective is always, it's not always, but the vast majority of the times is to minimize the travel costs associated to this fleet. And so we have customers that are that have supply, and we have to satisfy all the customers. And in some cases, as in this problem, we'll have some additional constraints as time windows and among others. Usually, from the classification of these type of problems, we have always to identify the road network, the set of vehicles that compose that fleet, the set of depots. There can be only one, but we can have a set of depots, the customers, the set of customers and their demand. With this type of elements, in some cases, we have different type of problems. Usually, we have the CVRP related with the capacity of the vehicles. That is the most common version that we saw, that we can see in literature. But in this problem, we have another kind of elements. The multi-compartments, we'll see what is in specifically in this problem, what is the VRP with multi-compartments. We'll have other variant of VRP, which is the VRP with time windows. And we'll have also the multi-trip issue, meaning that a vehicle can return to depot and reload, refill the vehicle and start again another route. The multi-depot variant of the VRP is not studied in this case, since the company has only one warehouse from the routes are beginning. The case study specifically for this company, well, it is a Portuguese full retail in the north of Portugal. The type of fuel that we distribute is the road fuel, the agricultural, and the heating diesel. So we have three types of fuel to deliver. And we have an heterogeneous fleet in this company. In this case, we have vehicles that have multiple compartments. Why? Because this kind of fuel cannot be mixed. So we have different compartments of different with different capacities. We'll consider the multi-trip variant, meaning that we return to the depot, we reload the vehicle, and the driver start again a new route. Time windows is considered, so each customer has a specific interval of time to satisfy their demand. And here our objective function is the sum of traveled distances. We can consider perhaps the minimization of the vehicles or maximization of visited customers, for instance, but the company has a problem that you can see in this square. Before this work at this company, something which is really surprising for us is the fact that the routes were planned completely empirically. So it is very surprising for us that there is not any kind of optimization or automatic process or something that could lead us to a solution that is acceptable. So the routes were planned empirically by distribution manager in the early morning for each day. So you can see a lot of work that this company has completely empirical. And the routes were defined by drivers based exclusively in their known of the routes. So we try to start thinking in solutions for this problem, and we start from heuristics. Why? Because we think in the first steps of this project that multi-compartment VRP could lead us to solutions that are very time consuming, and this company needs to have results very, very fast. So we start from the simple constructive heuristics that are very known in the literature, perhaps the most well-known, but also the very perhaps old constructive heuristic present in the literature is the Clark and Wright savings algorithm. So we start to think in apply this constructive heuristic and adapting this heuristic to the multi-compartment case. However, we also need to tackle the time window, so we have to adapt this heuristic also to consider the time windows of each customer. And we made three types of constructive heuristics. The first type is the basic version without multi-trip assumptions, so we cannot go to we cannot return to depot and reload our vehicles. In the second version, we can do that, and we have the explicit consideration of the multi-trip variant. And in the third case, we have test a kind of exchange of compartments mechanism. So we try to swap the full compartments in order to increase the number of valid solutions that we have. In order to understand to better understand this kind of methodology, I will just try to have a look in these heuristics. The version one, that is the version that we have assumed that a multi-trip variant cannot be considered. We have in step 1 to 5, perhaps you already saw something very similar, since it is based on the Clark and Wright heuristic. But here we have to merge customers based on the assumption that they can be feasible merged, considered not only the time windows but also the compartments. Here we have decided to order all the vehicles by the largest capacity and distribute the product load by the vehicle compartments. Again, in order to seek or increase the number of valid solutions, we test the reverse order of the hood, meaning that we, if perhaps we are visiting customers 1, 2, and 3, we also test the route 3, 2, 1 in order to see if a valid solution it is achieved. The version 2 is similar. As I said, in this case we consider that each vehicle can perform a set of trips instead of only one. And in the version 3 we have this kind of exchange mechanism. Perhaps an example can help us to understand this kind of exchange of compartments. Here we have a vehicle with three compartments for three types of fuel. And the question is if it is possible to introduce this demand on the third compartment of the vehicle. Obviously, as you can see, if the capacity is lower, we cannot do that. And why we implemented this exchange of compartments? Well, we'll try to see if there is a compartment that can swap the capacity. And in this case, perhaps we'll see that we have a valid solution. So we try to exchange all the compartments and see if a feasible solution is obtained. Not only a feasible solution, but we also want to minimize the objective function. So when we stop this mechanism, well, when a better and feasible solution is found, and when all the movements were already tested. After these three types of constructive heuristics, we start to think to go further. In this case, we think...
Elmo, you have a couple more minutes only.
Yes, I will finish. We'll start to think in the local search procedures that are very simple. In the first case, we start to think in try to swap customers. So we have intra-route local search. And in the second case, we'll try to mix the routes, exchanging customers between two different routes. We also implemented the decision support systems. As I said, the company has does not have any type of perhaps spreadsheet, Microsoft Excel or something. So we developed a decision support systems for this company to have not only the routes, but also the outputs and the key performance indicators that are important for this company. And we can see with our computational experiments four main results. First of all, we can increase the level of servicing 3%. We can, and the best result was this one, we can increase almost 20% of the work time, decrease almost 20% the working time. But the fuel consumption is very surprising even for us, since we can perform, we can save almost 20% of the fuel consumption, since the number of kilometers that are visited, that are traveled, are are lower than the real scenario. As we can see, the local search procedures that are the V3 to V3.2 are the best methods, which is not surprising since they are local search methods used to improve the constructive heuristics. In 1 year, we have this kind of values in terms of savings. So it is important to have this kind of automatic procedures and efficient solutions, even they are heuristic. So as to conclude, we try to develop a decision support systems for this company in order to have efficient solutions. And I can say to have a solution that we can call a solution with an automatic and standard process to improve our control from these methods. And as a future work, we have proposed an extension of the analyzed period of these computational experiments, the multi-depot variant that some companies can have a lot of depots. But I can tell you that we are at this moment tackling this problem with exact approaches to have solutions that are optimal, but we want to have this kind of solutions in the least possible time. So we are at this moment following this line of exact approaches for this problem. And thank you so much for your attention. I hope to obey this schedule. I'm sorry, Humberto.
It's fine. Okay, thanks a lot. Congratulations on your work and your presentation. And if anyone wants to pose questions, you can use chat, because we are a little behind schedule. And thanks, Telmo. We move to the last presentation, and it will be given by Luis Diaz, that I saw somewhere. Go ahead.
That's me. Good morning, all. Thank you. Thank you. Well, I'm going to share my document. Well,
yes.
Thank you. Well, this work was mainly developed by Catarina Mesquita. I was the second supervisor. The first one was Antonio Pieri. Well, in this work, it was developed in a core company, and as a challenge that is common to most companies today, we have to increase productivity, more flexibility, more quality, reduce costs, delays, and reduce the exposure to risks. Such improvements can be achieved by implementing tools to access internet information, in due time, namely as decision support tools. I'm trying just to show you the context of the of this project. This was developed in the cork industry, one of the biggest in Portugal and inherently in the world, as we have our leader in this field. The materials are rubber, foams, recycled plastics, and cork to create different products, joints, footwear, floors, consumer goods, and many others. So, in this tool, in this work, there were developed three different tools. Let's say one of them for searching reference that meet requirements, another tool for searching availability, and one different tool for making simulations of production. So the starting problem was mainly the information being spread among multiple sources in the company. So aided with the problem of some of the information being inside the head of supervisors or operators, it was not possible at that stage to have any kind of automation or optimization. Just to see what we are talking about, the searching in the information in the company took around 13 minutes for a simple search with a trained worker. Talking about the products, we have different properties for each one of them. So the density, the moles, availability, the history of using this kind of moles in this kind of products, alternatives, and other physical properties of each reference. The methodology used for the development of information research automation tools.
I'm sorry, Luis. I imagine that you are moving forward your slides, but we are stuck in the first one.
Yes. Oh, that's really bad. I cannot figure out.
Okay. Now it's moving.
Yes. Well. And I will keep this view. So in this view, I'm changing the slides, isn't it? So I'm changing from the 6 to the 7 now.
Yes. Okay. No, it's working.
Okay. So I will keep this view. I think it's fair enough. So the methodology used for develop the information research automation tools for searching the information in the company. So probably if I got lost some slides, maybe this one is important because the starting point when a lack of information was in the accessible in the system. So it was using Microsoft Excel and VBA for collecting information from different sources and creating a database to be accessible in the research tool. Also, this is the methodology used to develop the simulation tool. They are documented in the paper. This is the result of the research tool with many input parameters, and the result is presented in a table. So it's quite complex because this is not a simple quest, but a research with different criteria. we can see the use of the tool. I will keep up the sound. And as you can see, the user should fulfill the fulfill all the data and search and receive the data. The other research tool is about the availability of products, and a different tool was developed for that. The simulation was built for minimizing the risk of the system. So we could generate the model of the design in the factory, the finishing. We have the 3D layout. And we can just take a look on the animation of the design. So we have two different laminating machines, and the output of those two machines go to this one, the finishing. So the animation is important to validate the model, to make sure that the model we have is coherent with the idea of the system, and we can see the results. Three different scenarios were designed, three different experiments, A, B, and C. In the first one, two rewind lines are considered, as in the animation that we saw right now. In the experiment B, one of the rewinding lines was blocked, so just one working. In the experiment C, the packaging area, the second phase, was doubled. And the balanced system, we have here an interesting point of this system is that we can set up the simulation in an interface, and then the system runs the simulation based on the parameters. So this is the A in the balanced system. We can see here the buffer, the inner buffer is all the time zero. And this is the behavior of this balanced system. The unbalanced system, I'm going a bit further. We can see the buffer in between the laminating machines and the packaging area. You can see the buffer is growing from time to time, now bigger. And this is mitigating the performance of the system. This other scenario where with just one of the laminator machine working, the first one, the second one is blocked, so is off, and we can analyze the performance of the system with just one laminator. Finally, this scenario were designed with two laminator machines and one packaging area with double capacity. We can see two workers here from time to time or in this area. So the capacity, the working capacity increases. In all the simulations, I was jumping quickly, but in all the simulations, we can see the results. And in this table, the results are condensed in just one table. And we can see the key performance indicators, namely the number of rows produced per shift, where the higher value is in the experiment C with 375. So, as a conclusion, we in industrial context, we are always searching for continuous improvement of the process and increasing competitiveness. In this problem, one key element or one key value of this system is the information that in the beginning was spread in the company. As in the previous presentation of Telm, we saw that they decided the movement of vehicles without the information in the system. This was the same problem, the same starting point with a poor use of information. Now, after the work of Caterina, it was possible to gather all the information in a database and after that have a complex search system that had to comply with different conditions to have a result. Also with the simulations were important to make a complex analysis of the proposed system. Well, I'm leaving here the contact of Caterina that was not possible to be here presenting the work, and someone with more interest in the paper can address directly to Caterina with this email. Well, thank you and sorry for the
thank you, Luis. Just on time, very nice presentation and very nice animations. We don't have time. Just one out of curiosity, is it possible to know the name of the car company or is it secret?
No, it is not a secret. We have some information that is is not well, it can be shared
okay. The,
with the thesis, probably. I can send it later.
Okay, thanks again. And this last presentation ends this first COA session. Now it's a brief coffee break in our homes, most okay. Probably for all. And see you in 15 minutes.
Thank you to all the participants. See you in 15 minutes. See you later.
See you later.
Professor Rocha, good morning. Whenever you want, we can start.
Good morning.
Conversation.
Good morning.
I'll remind you the evaluation form that you should fill after the session for the selection of the best paper. Okay, thank you.
Não consigo ouvir.
Sim, também não estou a ouvir. Eu acho que a Ana está a falar, mas eu não estou a ouvir. Não estamos a ouvir. Não sei se...
Ok, Ana? Vamos tirar isto.
Ok, agora sim.
Agora já me estão a ouvir?
Sim,
agora sim.
Pronto, tenho que deitar fora estes auriculares todos, que não funcionam. Então não me estão a ouvir desde o início ou só foi a meio?
Só agora.
Ah, só agora. Ok, então aquilo estava a funcionar mais ou menos. Sorry. So, I expect that next year we will be in person in the ICCSA. Let's see if the pandemic situation will allow us to go. It is nice to see your faces, and I hope we will have a nice computational and optimization application session now. So let's beginning. It's about time to begin, I suppose. Yes. Let's the first speaker, Paula Amaral. Okay. You can start.
It's Rui Malha. Rui Malha.
Oh, Rui Malha. Okay. Thank you. So, Rui Malha, you can start sharing your presentation, please.
Okay. I hope you see my screen now.
Yes, you can see it.
Okay. Good morning. My name is Rui Malha, and this presentation is about a joint work with Paula Amaral on the subject, a maximal margin hypersphere support vector machine. So here is the outline of my talk. Because of time limitations, I will not go into too much details, but you can read the full text in the paper that will be published in the proceedings of this year's conference. In our days, the act of monitoring reached a hyperbolic state in the era of big data, fourth industrial revolution, Internet of Things, smart cities, smart cars, smart appliances. A support vector machine, a classification method introduced by Vapnik in 1995, has been used with success in classification and several generalizations of the boundary function. That means the classification function have been proposed since then in the literature. So the idea behind support vector machine is to find a hyperplane that separates two sets of data points, maximizing the margin. As you can see here in the figure, the highlighted points are the support vectors. This example is for R2, and new points are classified according to which side of the hyperplane they are. So you can see here the formulation for R2, and the goal is to maximize the minimum distance from the points of the different classes to the hyperplane. This distance we call the margin. After some algebra, we get the well-known support vector machine formulation here for the R2 case. Inspired by the standard formulation, some works have been made to improve a support vector machine, in particular using hyperspheres for classification. Here is a small survey of what has been published on this subject that you can read in detail in our paper. As you see, there's a lot of contributions in the recent years. So, given a set of points from two classes, the goal of classification is to find a separation function f of x and theta, where theta are the parameters of the function, and positive delta measures the separation between the sets of points. You have here the formulation, and in general, we may consider b equals to zero. So, to find the optimal parameter values represented by theta and the margin, delta, an optimization problem of the following type must be solved. Here, the function of delta is a strictly increasing function on R plus. Our proposal is to find the radius R and the center x0 of a hypersphere so that the points of one class fall inside the hypersphere and the points of the other class, C2, fall outside the hypersphere, as you can see here in the figure. There's a margin, delta, separating the points from the two classes, as in the standard support vector machine. Notice that the center of the hypersphere is not necessarily rooted at the center of the set of points from one class and may even be far outside the centroid. So the separation curve may approximate or not a linear separator depending on the point's configuration, which is an advantage. So, the goal is to find the center x0 and the radius r that maximizes non-negative delta, that means the margin. We have here the problem formulation. We are going to consider the function of delta equals to delta, and we assign a label y equals to plus minus 1 to differentiate the classes. The formulation is as follows for both classes. After some algebra, we arrive to the following equivalent problem. So we want to maximize the margin, delta, subject to these conditions. And this is a quadratic optimization problem. But we also propose a linear relaxation of the quadratic formulation. So, from the constraints we had before, we can obtain this new formulation. And since here r square r plus square delta appears on both inequalities, we can rewrite this in a unique expression you see here below. So, we have this expression, which is equivalent to this one, and also to this one. And this expression here in the middle, we take out this expression and we get this final inequality. And so any feasible solution of the quadratic problem verifies these constraints. We can rearrange this expression and find this one here below. Taking now theta equals to r times delta, we come to the final formulation of the linear relaxation for the quadratic problem, as you can see. This problem may be unbounded because if this expression here is negative, then x0 can be chosen to be arbitrarily large And to solve this issue, we propose an indirect regularization technique. Instead of adding to the objective function minus k times x0 norm, where k is a parameter, we introduce a new variable, rho, and a new constraint in the above formulation. And we obtain the final linear relaxation formulation, as you can see here. We tried this quadratic and linear hypersphere support vector machine method with a simple example on two sets of points in R2, and we got these results. As you see, you can see here the result using the quadratic formulation, and here the separation line using the linear formulation. The quadratic is slightly better than the linear formulation for this case, of course. About our computational experience, these are the characteristics of the computer we used. We used the Baran solver for solving the quadratic formulation. About the data sets, we use two data sets. The SIDS data set, which is the real data available from UCI machine learning repository. And we also build an artificial data set in order to have two sets spherically separated. About accuracy results, we got a better classification performance when using the quadratic model, as you can see here in this table. For the linear model, the performance was slightly worse with the artificial data and better with the SIDS dataset when compared with the classic support vector machine. Concerning the significance of these results, we made some statistical hypothesis tests for both SIDS dataset and generated data. And globally, we can conclude that there is only statistical evidence of the outperformance of the quadratic model in comparison with the classic support vector machine model. So, now the conclusions, we made a new formulation with a hypersphere separation, maximizing the margin. This formulation is a generalization of the classic support vector machine. We present a linear relaxation for this quadratic problem and the development of the regularization procedure for avoiding unboundedness. The preliminary results we found seem promising. We got a good approximation for the quadratic solution, which is computational cheaper since it is based on a linear formulation. In the future, we intend to explore the dual problem and to adjust the formulation to non-separable classes and multi-class classification. Okay, thank you very much for attending this talk, and for more details, you are welcome to read our paper. Thank you.
Thank you. I don't know if you have any questions. Okay, any questions or any remark?
May I place one?
Yes.
Okay. Is there any class of problems that inspired you in separating with an hypersphere rather than an hyperplane?
Yes, indeed. I tried these hyperspheres because I'm studying another problem where I intend we intend to apply this this method, and because we think it's a good solution for the other problem, and so comes this idea of working with hyperspheres instead of a hyperplane. And this is as an advantage because since the center and the radius can be large, can be far from the line, this line can adjust, can be adjusted to the configuration of points. And so can be almost as equal as an hyperplane if the center is far away. So it's a flexible face to the configuration of points.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. Guys, can I say something?
Yes, you can say something.
Ah,
it's nice to hear.
No, my question I also put in the chat. I have the feeling that the hypersphere is a relatively, from an optimization point of view, is a relatively an easy problem to solve. So a next challenge could be not to make it more complicated, could be to start thinking about an ellipsoidal vector machine, let's say it like that, where you not only have the center, but also actually the matrix, the symmetric matrix to describe the ellipsoid.
Mm-hmm.
Other thoughts about working on that, or that's not where you want to go?
Thank you, Elysius. Just a remark, no, to Rui. Okay. I don't know if we want to say something.
No, no. Yes, yes. Thank you.
Cool. So this is a, it was a very interesting approach for SVM classification. Thank you. If there are no more questions, we should go to the next speaker, Humberto. I think it's Humberto Rocha, to show us a randomized direct search approach for beam angle optimization in intensity modulated proton therapy. Humberto, you can share.
Yes. Okay, so 10 minutes is very fast. I will speed up the first part. So the title is a randomized direct search approach for beam angle optimization in intensity modulated proton therapy. And this work is...
Humberto, sorry, yes. You are not sharing?
I am not.
So okay. You are sharing, but not the presentation.
And what about now?
Not yet.
No,
okay, let's start again.
See your monitor.
No.
What about now?
No, we are only see your face.
Mm.
Try again, please. Maybe you have another screen.
Oh, yes, okay. I do. No.
Okay, now we see that you are sharing. Okay, now we can see your presentation.
Now we can see. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Okay, starting again and even faster. I will present a randomized direct search approach for beam angle optimization in intensity modulated proton therapy. And this work follows other works, and the two distinguished features are that we are addressing protons instead of photons, and it is a very important feature. And the second one, and most important for this type of presentation or for this type of audience, is the algorithm. We propose a randomized direct search instead of a deterministic one. So the outline is the following. I'll start by briefly describing the problem, then describing deterministic and probabilistic direct search. Then I will present our proposed randomized direct search approach for this problem, some computational results and conclusions. So what is intensity modulated proton therapy? Well, it's about the same type of therapy than with photons, which is the most common. Actually, in Portugal, we and in the Iberia, there is not yet protons. In Portugal, we are working on that. In Lisbon, there are a huge project to bring a proton center to Portugal. And the objectives of this therapy are exactly the same as the one that we have for some years now. And the objectives are to kill the cancer cells in the tumor, but at the same time to spare the surrounding organs and tissues. This therapy is delivered with the patient immobilized on a couch that can rotate, and the radiation beams are delivered around the patient using a gantry that rotates along a central axis. And the rotation of both the gantry and the couch allows the irradiation of the patients from almost any direction around the tumor. So what are the difference between what are the differences between protons and photons? Here we have a figure where we can see the characteristics of both protons and photons irradiation. We can see that for protons, we have a low entrance dose, and then we have a sharp peak that is called a Bragg peak, and then we have a rapid distal dose fall off. And this is a very nice characteristics because if we are able to place the peak inside the tumor, it's easier it's easier to have a good trade-off between tumor coverage and organ sparing. Here we have an example for a single beam using in the left photons and in the right protons. And we can see that we have high doses at entrance for photons, and then the dose will decrease until the tumor. So we need different, a large number of beams centered in the tumor so we can achieve the desired prescribed dose. While for protons, we see that we have a small amount of dose before the tumor, and then a high dose at the tumor and almost no dose after the tumor. So protons are very interesting to treat cancer lesions, but still it is required to find the best beam directions and to optimize a number of parameters. In this work, we will find the best irradiation directions, which is the beam angle optimization problem. And considering a non-coplanar setting and considering n to be the number of beam directions, a basic formulation for the beam angle optimization problem is easily obtained by selecting an objective function such that the best set of beams is obtained for the function minimum. Typically, the function or the measure considered to compare different sets of beams is the optimal value of the fluence map optimization problem. That is the problem of finding the best irradiations for each beam. In order to solve this problem, we use MATRAD, which is an open source radiotherapy treatment planning system. And here we have an example for a prostate case, and we have only two parallel opposed beam irradiation directions. Previously in our works, we used direct search algorithms to address the beam angle optimization problem for photons. And direct search algorithms are suited to address this problem because it's a highly non-convex problem with many local minimum. And these algorithms have two important features. The first one is that they do not use derivatives, so they are quite good avoiding local entrapment. And the second one is that they converge in a small amount of time. Regardless of that, we made several attempts to decrease the computational time. The interest of direct search is based on positive basis directions. And a positive basis is a set of vectors that positively span the entire space. And positive basis has at least n plus one vectors, and it's called a minimal positive basis, and at most 2n vectors. Here we have examples for 2D and 3D positive bases. And the main feature of positive bases in terms of the derivative-free algorithms is the following. Giving any vector, we can always find a vector of a positive basis that forms an acute angle with that vector. In particular, if that vector is the gradient vector, we can always find a vector that forms an acute angle with the gradient vector, and we can prove that that vector is a descent direction, in the sense that if we follow that direction, we will end up by improving or decreasing the objective function of the current iterate unless the current heat rate is already a stationary point. So this motivates the use of positive basis directions in directional direct search. And the typical framework for the direct search algorithm is this. And it's organized in two steps, a search step and a post step. The search step gives flexibility to this algorithm, and we can use any strategy or heuristic we want, as long as it's a finite search. And this gives a global aspect to this algorithm. And the post step uses more strict rules using the directions of positive bases, and is this step that guarantees convergence to a stationary point. In this work, we will typically, most of our previous work, we use some sort of creativity to use strategies, different strategies for the search step. In this work, the search step is empty, and we will focus on the poll step. Typically, in all our previous work, we use deterministic direct search. And in order to guarantee convergence to a stationary point, the pole directions must contain a positive basis. This is quite interesting because we have the guarantee of convergence to a stationary point, but remember that the minimal positive basis has at least n plus one directions. So at each iteration, if n is a large space, we have a large number of attempts. The alternative probabilistic direct search states that we don't need to have necessarily a positive basis, and we can test a reduced number of directions at each iteration. This idea is recent, and recently some works show that using a small number of directions at each iteration can produce high quality results at a smaller computational time. So using that idea, we will propose the following. In our proposal, we propose to randomly select directions uniformly sampled by quadrants, and here we have examples for 2D and 3D. Note that for 2D, the number of uniform directions is equal to 2n, but for 3D, it's larger than 2n, the maximal positive basis. Actually, for any dimension, the number of suggested possible directions is 2 to the power of n, that is increasingly larger than 2n. So using our probabilistic approach, selecting 1, 2, n plus 1, 2n, 3n, and up to 4n directions at each iteration, we compare that approach with the traditional deterministic approach using a maximal positive basis and a minimal positive basis. And we compare these results with the benchmark, which was the two parallel opposed directions. In terms of quality on the left of the solution measured by the optimal fluence map optimization value, we can see that all the optimized plans clearly improve the benchmark solution, which is good. And we can see that the probabilistic solutions are similar in terms of quality to the deterministic solutions, with a small decrease of quality for when considering only two or only one directions at each iteration. We also compare the computational time. Obviously, the benchmark solution is for free, but in terms of computational times, when considering a small number of directions at each iteration, for instance, two, the computational time is reduced to less than half of the deterministic approaches. So, since the quality is about the same and the computational time is decreased, this is a promising approach. typically, the assessment of the quality of a solution is not made by looking only at the value of the optimal solution of the fluence map optimization problem, but we look at those volume histograms, and for the tumors, we want that the tumor have 100% of the dose up until the prescribed dose, and we want no dose at the organs at risk, but that's not possible. So we want the small amount of dose possible. We compare the benchmark solution. We compare the deterministic solution for the maximal positive basis, which was the best in terms of quality. And we can compare an average solution for the probabilistic approach with two directions at each iteration. In terms of tumor coverage, we can see that the optimized plans are similar, but way better than the benchmark solution. In terms of organ sparing, we can see that both the benchmark and the probabilistic approach outperform the deterministic approach. So adding the tumor coverage and the organ sparing, we can say that the probabilistic approach is very competitive, and in this case outperforms the other two solutions in a small amount of computational time. Finally, we have here depicted the solutions. We have here the two parallel opposed beam directions, and we can see that the deterministic and the probabilistic approaches are close in terms of, are spatially close, which is an interesting feature. So finally, we propose a randomized direct search approach that is very competitive in terms of the quality of the solutions, and particularly in terms of the computational time. And for this prostate cancer case that we test, this approach was very good. In future work, we need to validate this with more cases and different tumors. Thank you.
Thank you, Humberto. We are a little run out of time, but just time for one question. Or I can have a question. So you made an approach that we saw the computational time was decreased, although a decrease in the results obtained. Do you want to comment this? So
yes. Well, the idea of using a probabilistic approach came from other works, recent works, that use less directions at each iteration in benchmark problems. And they show that reducing the number of directions at each iteration clearly improves the computational times, and the decrease in the quality of the solution is very small. Obviously, by using a probabilistic approach, we don't have the guarantee of convergence to stationary point. However, our goal is to obtain a global optimum, and we don't have any guarantees with either of the methods. So the probabilistic approach obtains fairly good results in terms of quality, but we spend way less computational time, which is very important in this type of problems.
Okay, thank you. If there are no more questions, we can pass to the next speaker, Gisela. You can start sharing your screen.
Yeah. Aqui, neste.
Não.
Okay, you can start. Thank you.
Eu não tenho que ligar. Okay, hello. My presentation is about optimal control. Can you hear me?
Yes. Yes, we can hear and see the presentation.
Okay. My presentation is about optimal control by multiple shooting and weighted Chebyshev penalty-based scalarization. My name is Gisela. This is a joint work with Edith Fernandes, Ana Rocha, and Fernanda Costa. This is the outline of the talk. I will briefly describe the direct multi-shooting method, the proposed multi-objective formulation, and strategy to solve the problem. Finally, I show the numerical experiments and conclusions. First, to solve optimal control problems in the Meyer form using a direct multi-shooting method. Second, to use a multi-objective optimization formulation to minimize the objective function and to efficiently handle the continuity constraints that emerge from the use of the MES method and as well as other algebraic mixed state and control constraints. The weighted Chebyshev scalarization method is used to minimize simultaneously the objective function, the continuity constraints violation, and the algebraic mixed state and control constraints violation. An OCP is a constraint optimization problem that has a set of dynamic equations as constraints. There are three types of OCP, Bolza, Lagrange, or Meyer form. They differ in the formulation of the objective functional J to be optimized. In the Meyer form, you want minimize J, which is a function of big T, final value of the interval, subject to a set of dynamic equations, initial values and final values, where Y is the vector of state variables, U is the vector of control variables, and big U represents a class of functions. The goal of an OCP is to find the control vector that minimizes the objective functional J subject to a dynamic system of ordinary differential equations. The problem may have other constraints, more complex terminal constraints, mixed state and control algebraic constraints. Methods for solving OCP can be classified into indirect and direct methods. Indirect methods use the first order necessary conditions from Pontryagin maximum principle to reformulate the original problem into a boundary value problem. Direct methods transform the infinite dimensional OCP into a finite dimensional optimization problem that can be solved by popular NLP algorithms. In a direct method, the controls U are discretized on a grid defined by T1, T2, and so on. The control U is discretized using, for example, a piecewise constant. In a direct multi-shooting method, the decision variables for the NLP solver are the discretized controls QI, as well as the vector of start values for the state variables at the grid, XI. After discretization, the controls of the ODE system is solved on each subinterval independently by an ODE solver to get the values of the start vector for the optimization. However, they need to be linked by the variables xi for the n-1 independent initial value problem on the subintervals. The start values for the state variables xi should satisfy the continuity conditions, the initial values, and the final values. The resulting NLP problem has the form: minimize with respect xi and qi the objective, subject to the algebraic inequality constants, the algebraic equality constants, continuity constants, and initial and final constants. Thus, we seek optimal values for the x and the q such that all the constants are satisfied, meaning that we seek a feasible solution and the objective function takes the least value. The to check feasibility, you use a measure for the violation of the constraints. Two sets are defined and the violation are handled separately. The violation of the continuity constraints is defined by theta. The violation of algebraic equality and inequality constraints is P, is defined by this. In this NLP, we aim to minimize simultaneously the feasibility measures, which are the violation of the continuity constants and the violation of algebraic constraints, and the optimality measure. Thus, the three objective optimization problem is minimize theta, P, and M, F1, F2, F3. The purpose of multi-objective optimization is to optimize conflicting objectives simultaneously. The optimal solution is not a single solution, is a set of solutions with objective function values that cannot be simultaneously improved. It is a set of non-dominated solutions. It is the Pareto front in the objective space. The goal of an MOO algorithm is to find a good approximation to the Pareto front. A single solution can be found by aggregating the objective functions into a scalar objective function used in the single objective optimization context. The weighted Chebyshev approach is a nonlinear weighted aggregation of the Fi given by this expression, where W is a vector of non-negative weights and Z star is the ideal point in objective space. We added a penalty term to Psi to accelerate convergence of the constraint violation to zero. Now you want to minimize Pi. Minimize Pi J gives approximation to Pareto front by varying the vector of the weights.
Gisela, I'm sorry, but your time is finishing, so you must finish, please.
Okay.
Go to the experiment, please.
Okay. The force or the proposed methodology was tested with 6 OCPs. The fourth order Runge-Kettig formula is used to solve the ODE system in each subinterval. A total of 21 of positive weights are generated using the simplex lattice design method. Pi is not smooth at some points. Thus, the F-min search from MATLAB is used to minimize its Pi J. The formulation of the problem trajectory. Plot A shows the Pareto front where the red circle are non-dominated solutions, and plot C and D show the state variable and control variable. For the other problems, I have the formulation of Van der Pol, the figures, and the problem of Sackel and the figure, the plot of Pareto front and state and control variables. For the reactor problem, the same, and the problem Fuller, and finally the tank reactor problem. As you can see, the non-dominated solutions and the state variables and control variable. And we show in this table the best selected solutions, the non-dominated solutions. Is the one of smallest theta value. For example, for the reactor problem, the best solution was obtained in the third run. This table aims to show the proposed methodology, require very few functions, evaluations, and time. Now, finally, with the Chebyshev scalarization methodology is proposed to solve a finite dimensional NLP problem that arises from the use of a direct multi-shooting method for OCP. The methodology aggregates three objective functions that are minimized simultaneously: the violation of the continuity constraints, the violation of the algebraic constraints, and the objective function. A penalty term is added to the Chebyshev objective to force the constraint violation to decrease even faster. The preliminary experiments show the effectiveness of the methodology when compared to similar strategies and similar computational effort. And thanks for your attention.
Thanks, Gisela. We are extremely lucky of time, so if there are any questions, you can chat them, please. And now you should go to the next speaker. That should start Angela. I don't know if it is Angela or Clara.
No, it's me. I'm the presenter.
Clara, okay. Nice to see you, Clara Vaz. She will present the last paper of this session.
So are you seeing my screen?
Yes. we are seeing and we are hearing you. You can start.
Okay, okay, thank you. So I will present.
Sorry, can you just enlarge the window?
And the ah, line? Yes.
It will be difficult to see the.
Okay. So I will present this work about assessing the deployment of electric mobility. It is a review that is a joint work with Sara Grutzmacher and Angela Ferreira. So I will present the motivation of this study, what are the objectives, the context related with electric vehicles, typologies and policies on electric vehicles, the methodology adopted, the results, and finally, I will conclude. So, in order to meet the climate goal defined in the Paris Agreement, the European Union set in 2014 a target of 40% reduction in the domestic greenhouse emissions for each country. As we can observe in this, on the left graph, we see that half of the European countries have already achieved their
goal. Sorry, but you are not scrolling the slides. We are in the first slide. Maybe you are sharing not the right screen.
Sorry, and if you can put it in...
maybe in the other screen, the other screen is the other... You should start a share again, please.
Okay, so. So are not seeing.
No.
Okay.
Change your screen. No, not yet. We are seeing our faces.
Okay. I'm using the Chrome.
It's okay. Using Google Chrome is the best solution. Maybe you should try again. Okay, now we can see your screen.
So you are seeing my screen,
but not your presentation. So when you share the screen, you select your monitor and then you open your presentation.
And now?
Now we can see your
presentation. Are you seeing?
Yes.
Can you make Control L maybe? If it
would be... okay. I can. Okay. Enlarge. So are you seeing?
Yes.
We see your presentation.
Are you seeing my presentation?
Yes, we see it.
Not in the view mode, but
okay.
Okay.
Okay. Are you? I'm scrolled down, and you are seeing. Okay.
So can you experiment to scroll down? No, we cannot. We can't see the scrolling. Just see the overview slide.
Yes.
Okay. And now?
Now.
And then scrolling down. Okay.
Okay. Are you seeing now?
Yes, we are.
So, firstly, I'm presenting the targets about the countries that we can observe that the half of European countries have already achieved their target, but some work needs to be done. For example, we see reduction of the emissions in all sectors of economy. However, the Europe transport sector have increased these emissions, and we can see that these emissions corresponds to 28% of total emissions in 2018. We can see that these more than 73% of the transport GHG emissions came from road transportation. Basically, the passenger cars largely dominate the inland passenger transport, accounting for about 80% of total volume. In 2019, petrol passenger cars accounted for 60%. So we can see on the right that the passenger cars are responsible for more than 60% of total GHG emissions from road transportation. Some changes, it is important to reduce, to mitigate these emissions, and some changes were proposed in the white paper on transport strategy from 2011. Some of them are, for example, halving the number of petrol in the cities by 2030, phasing petrol cars out of the cities by 2050, and using cleaner energy on road transport. Deployment of electric vehicle is a strategy adopted for many countries to reduce the use of fossil fuels and further mitigate GHG emissions. And this explains why electric mobility has been receiving much more attention in recent years, and the electric vehicle fleet is rapidly expanding. For example, we can see that although the pandemic situation, all the while the sales of electric vehicles in 2020 have increased 43% when compared to 2019, and in Europe this growth was of more than 137% for the same period. So the objective of this study is to explore and analyze recent literature on the deployment of electric vehicles regarding their environment and energy sustainability. Basically, the objective is to typify this kind of the objectives of these papers, the methods used, the indicators to better understand the state of the art on this topic. We identify four different types of powertrain configurations for electric vehicles: battery electric vehicle, fully electric, only uses one or more electric motor, not dependent of fossil fuel. The plug-in hybrid electric vehicles that combines the electric motor with plug-in battery with internal combustion engine, and the hybrid electric vehicle depends on oil fossil fuel, combines internal combustion engine with electric motor to improve the fuel efficiency, and the fuel cell electric vehicle not dependent of fossil fuel that uses the electric powertrain powered by a fuel cell stack device. To promote the deployment of electric vehicles, the government have introduced some policies at the consumer level. Almost all of the European countries apply some kind of fiscal measures, such, for example, purchase subsidies, these tax benefits exemptions to stimulate the electric vehicle purchase. Concerning the car manufacturer, the European Union set a mandatory target for the average emission of the manufacturer over fleet of the new passenger cars of 95 grams of CO2 per kilometer by 2021. From the electrification of the transport sector in 2020, 10 of the 28 countries analyzed have surpassed the 10% market share of battery electric vehicles and hybrid vehicles, in which we identified Denmark, Finland, Netherlands, Portugal, and Sweden. So, in terms of the methodology used, is to review the literature to analyze the methods used to assess the deployment of electric vehicles through a set of indicators by using the Web of Science database, and we made a search for journal papers published in the last 11 years, and we can see that using the term electric vehicles returns more than 16,000 articles. So this topic has an exponential growth in the last years. So using the VOSE viewer software, identify for bigger clusters. These clusters are related with the batteries development, the electric vehicles design in terms of system and motor, the electric vehicles impact on the energy system, and in terms and in the topic that we are studying, the electric vehicles deployment and adoption, sustainability, mobility, government policies and incentives. So in this cluster, we use some relevant keywords and apply a search engine such as electric vehicles, sustainable deployment or adoption. And we identified that several indicators to assess the deployment of the electric vehicles with using some quantitative methodologies. These indicators can be classified into major emissions, economic group, such as government incentives, GDP per capita, social, such as job creation, income, consumer awareness, and technical group, which includes charging, for example, charging infrastructure, free charging points, and so on. So in general, we see that the most used indicators in the papers are the government incentives, charging infrastructure, and electric vehicle typology, market share. That the methodologies that are adopted by the study are diverse, depending on the type of data used, and the various possible approach to explore the electric vehicle deployment or adoption. So we can conclude that although most sectors of the European economy have been reducing their GHG emissions, the transport sector has been increasing their emissions since 2014, in which the road, mainly the major cars, is the main contributor. In 2020, registrations of electric vehicles in the European Union have increased almost 140% when compared with 2019, which results from the electrification of the transport sector strategy in the European Union. To achieve these, some policies, plans are applied and are dependent on region, since their characteristics and needs can vary significantly. So most authors point out that the main contributors to the deployment of electric vehicles are high density of recharging points, the existence of government monetary incentives, and the lower operational cost of electric vehicles. As the electric vehicles market deploys, research direction should be updated to include other indicators, for example, the instance driving range. It is important that development of the new electricity market frameworks on a two-way bridge edge concept. It will be very important to support the transition to the electrified road transportation. Thank you.
Thank you, Clara. So this is a presentation about the methodology and the indicators on the deployment of electrical vehicles. This is a very nice presentation and a very interesting study. I don't know if anybody has any comment, mainly people that has electrical vehicles. No? Okay. There are some people that really, really are interested, and me also, okay, in the future. It's a future.
Yes.
Thank you, Clara. Any question? Any question or remark from the audience? No? Okay. Thank you, Clara. Before ending this session, we have another session of computational and optimization applications at 10:30. So we have 10 minutes, but before ending this session, I want to inform you that the proceedings are available in our submission site. So if you enter in your submission site where you register, and after registering, you have the where you submit the papers and so on. So there you have all the volumes, 10 volumes that were published, 10 proceedings volumes of lecture notes. Our the volume 5 is our papers from this workshop. Okay, so in these 10 minutes, this break, you can go there and download for 1 month. We have 1 month to download the proceedings. So the proceedings of our workshop, in optimization workshop, are in the volume 5. Okay, see you about 10:30. Okay, thank you all.
Thank you very much to all.
Okay, you. Thank you.
Thank you.
See you.
See you.
Thank See you. You.
Thank you.
See you.
So this is just a break to a virtual coffee. Okay.
Olá, Ana.
Olá, Paula. Então,
ninguém foi uma boa sessão. Foi uma ótima sessão. Gostei imenso.
Gostaste?
Gostei. Opa, ontem assisti a uma sessão onde atropelaram os horários todos. Foi uma chatice, porque tudo aquilo que eu queria assistir, não assistia nada.
Pois, ficou tudo confuso, não é?
É, porque faltou um, então resolveram passar à frente para o outro, etc. E às tantas eu cheguei lá e perguntei pela coisa, já tinha acabado. Acho que sim. Esta correu muito bem. Só podia.
É, obrigada. Obrigada. Temos assim um pouquinho de tempo de intervalo, mas na verdade os nossos intervalos também, se tivesse só um coffee break, eu nem sei se há lá coffee break, mas acho que não. O Eligius acho que é o único.
Está lá?
Presente, ele está lá.
Ah, ele está lá, ok.
Tá, é o único na sala.
Ok, está bom.
Agora deve ter tido mesmo um break, senão já tinha aí entrado.
Bom dia. É.
Olá, bom dia, Ana Cristina.
Tudo bem?
Está tudo bem. Eu acho que está a correr bem. As pessoas
eu
estão.
Também me parece. Só estão tenho bem. Uma dúvida. Sim. Esse o logo, nós acedemos a ter esse logo só quando somos os shares ou os host.
Mas que logo? Não.
O que está do canto esquerdo? Que tu tens.
Vocês estão a ver alguma coisa? Não sou
agora só está o assim, moderador, o technical support.
Pronto, o que está lá na sala é que põe isto, não sou eu. Eu não ponho nada. Eu não fiz nada, tá?
Ok, ele já mudou, tu já não tens, ainda tens lá um coisinho, mas deve ser ele. Deve ser na plataforma dele que ele coloca. É. Conforme é o moderador, ele coloca do canto.
É, ele é que está vivo,
21.
Olha, eu até trouxe uma t-shirt do Ixa.
Eu já vi, só que é da mesma cor, mas tem 17.
As deste ano também são pretas e aqui no meio é que é. Pronto, não temos direito a nada, mas para o ano teremos. Certo, Paula?
Sim.
Melhores dias virão.
Olha, vou fazer
mesmo. Tchau, Ana. Beijocas.
Até já. Vou para outra sala. Beijinhos. Tchau.
Hi, Humberto, are you chairing the session? Okay.
Yes.
Sorry. Okay. So I just wanted to make sure that I can share. So all I have to do is share the screen, right? And that you know. So if I do this, because just wanted
yes.
that you guys are seeing it.
Yes, we are already seeing that.
Okay, you're seeing this.
Yeah.
So is there a way for me to see both the what's this the because I'm not see, when I shared my screen, I don't see all the any of the videos at all. Is that normal? Well,
yes, that happened to me. So you will only see your presentation, but that's
okay,
fine.
So I don't we see are, anyone else.
Yeah, we are seeing your presentation and the rest.
Okay, so right now you're seeing my presentation.
No, I was, but now it's black.
Oh, okay. Now you're seeing.
Now I'm seeing. Yeah.
Okay. I see. All right.
No, actually, now I'm seeing Eligio's, not yours.
Oh.
It's Eligio's presentation.
Oh, how does it? Okay. So
maybe they are there. Okay, no, they were
the sharing of the presentation, which is due this afternoon. So it will be presented this afternoon. Sorry for the.
It's okay.
Inconvenient.
Sorry. So I do. So I have to reshare it again, like this.
Oh, sorry.
Yes.
Okay. So just let me know. Do I start now or?
No, just a couple of more minutes.
Okay. Sure. I will just wait. Just let me know.
Yeah.
So I'll keep my screen on.
Yeah, you're fine.
And we should do a full screen. So you're still seeing it, right?
Yes, it's perfect. Okay, and since the time for presentation is quite short, and to avoid some types of delay, I will start the third session of computational optimization and applications. And the first presentation is the one that is showing now in the screen. Rommel, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you very much. Hello, good morning. So my talk is about a high-dimensional, constrained, discrete, expansive black box optimization using a two-phase surrogate approach. So my goal is to find an approximate optimal solution to the following problem with ordinal discrete variables. So I wanted to minimize some function f of x subject to some inequality constraints, and then the requirement that the variables xi are ordinal discrete variables. So here, di is the finite set of possible discrete ordinal settings of the ith variable. So for example, xi belongs to the set di consisting of this set of numbers. And notice that the numbers don't have to be integers. And then the functions f of x and the objective function and the constraint functions are black box and computationally expensive. And here, I'm going to assume that one simulation yields the values, all the values of the objective and all the constraint functions for a given input x. So there are many real-world expensive black box optimization problems. So for example, in aerospace design, car structure design, in fact, the proposed method will be applied to some benchmark problem based on a real-world car structure design problem from Mazda. So there are many surrogate-based optimization methods in the literature, but relatively few can handle discrete decision variables. And surrogate-based methods for high-dimensional problems with hundreds of discrete variables and many constraints are actually rare. Now, here are some examples of surrogate-based approaches for optimization problems with discrete variables. So the first three methods are based on Krigging or Gaussian process models. In fact, many of you are probably familiar with the EGO method. So this is the version that works for mixed variable problems. There was also a thesis written by Zafirer on surrogates for discrete optimization problems. And there's also a surrogate-based evolutionary algorithm for design optimization discrete variables. However, many of these methods will only be tested on problems with less than 25 variables, and some do not even handle black box constraints. So Condor is an algorithm, a surrogate-based algorithm for constrained black box optimization with ordinal discrete variables. It can be used for high-dimensional problems, that means high-dimensional decision variables with many black box inequality constraints, but the original version requires a feasible initial point. So this talk proposes two-phase Condor, which is an extension of Condor that can be used even if none of the initial points are feasible. So here's the general structure of two-phase Condor. So you start the algorithm, you run simulations to get the objective and constraint values at some initial points, so typically from a space filling design, and then you check your computational budget. If it hasn't been reached, you check if there's a feasible sample point. If there's not a feasible sample point, you select a simulation point for phase one. If there is a feasible sample point, you select a simulation point for phase two. In either case, whatever simulation point you obtain, so you run the simulation on that point to get the objective and constraint values. And then again, check your computational budget. If it hasn't been reached, you iterate. Otherwise, you stop and return the best feasible point. So in phase one, all sample points are infeasible, and the algorithm searches for a feasible point. So in each iteration, the algorithm identifies the infeasible points that are non-dominated according to three potentially conflicting criteria. So these are the number of constraint violations, the maximum constraint violation, and the sum of squares of the constraint violations. We're going to randomly choose one of these non-dominated points and generate a large number of trial points in its neighborhood. And the next simulation point is chosen from the trial points using the predicted values of the above constraint violation criteria. So basically, with the surrogates, you have predicted values of each of these criteria, and you use that to select your next simulation point. In phase two, at least one sample point is feasible, and the algorithm searches for an optimal solution. In each iteration, the algorithm generates, again, a large number of trial points in the neighborhood of the current best feasible solution, and the next simulation point is chosen from trial points with the minimum number of predicted constraint violation as predicted by the surrogates for the constraints. Again, you're going to pick your simulation point using surrogate and distance criteria. So there are two parameters that control the generation of trial points. One is called the perturbation probability, which is the probability of perturbing each coordinate of a given solution vector. The other is the neighborhood depth parameter, which is a fraction of the number of settings of the variable that's allowed to increase or decrease. So to illustrate the neighborhood depth parameter, suppose that the current setting of a variable xi is equal to 1.8, and the possible values of xr are given by this set of numbers. So let the neighborhood depth parameter be 20%, then that means xi will increase or decrease by up to 20% of its possible discrete settings. So in this case, we'll take the ceiling of 0.2 times the number of points in di, and that's equal to two levels. So that means, if the current setting is 1.8, you're allowed, when you perturb this particular variable, you're allowed to go two levels up or two levels down. So in this case, we're going to use the radial basis function model as a surrogate. So let E of X be the objective or constraint function given n distinct sample points. We use a model of the form given by this formula. So you have this linear combination of basis functions plus a linear polynomial tail. And in this case, I'm using the cubic form, phi of r equals r cubed, but other forms of phi are also possible. The fitting this model is actually very simple. It just involves solving a linear system, and it's relatively fast. And this model has been used for high dimensional problems with hundreds of discrete decision variables. Now we're going to, a two-phase condor will be tested on discrete versions of well-known benchmark problems, G7, G9, and G19. And these are the dimensions and the number of constraints. It's also tested on the single objective version of the Mazda 3-car benchmark problem, where the goal is to determine the thicknesses of 222 structural parts that minimize the total weight of three types of Mazda cars while satisfying 54 inequality constraints, such as collision safety performances. The number of settings of each variable ranges from 4 to 18, and the search space has about 4.44 times 10 to the 198, which is actually beyond astronomical. It's actually more than the number of atoms in the observable universe. Three variants of two-phase condor are implemented. So actually, in all these variants are performing local, some form of local and global search, but the local variant does more local searching. The global variant does more global searching in both phases one and two, whereas the mixed variant does more global search on phase one and more local search on phase two. And the way these variants work is that they're, it depends on the setting of the perturbation probability and the neighborhood depth parameter. So the two-phase condor algorithms are compared with NOMAD, the direct search NOMAD, MATLAB's GA solver with various crossover fractions. Each algorithm was run for 30 trials on each artificial test problem with a budget of 40 D simulations, where D is the number dimension of the problem. And each algorithm was run for 10 trials up to a maximum of 10 D or 2,320 simulations on the master benchmark, because that one's more expensive. All algorithms used the same initial set of points in a given trial. So these are some results. So this is showing you the mean of the number of objective and constraint function evaluations to obtain a feasible point. So the best results are highlighted. And you can see here that the contour algorithms, the two variants here, consistently required much less objective and constraint function evaluation to obtain a feasible point compared to, say, Nomad and the GM methods. And the results for local global variance are actually comparable. So the numbers here are close. This is showing the mean of the best feasible objective function value obtained in ATD function evaluations. Again, comparing Condor and Nomad, GA was not included because the results are actually much worse. The Condor algorithms, again, obtained better feasible objective function values than Nomad and, of course, also GA, especially on this G19 discrete version of G19. And you can see the discrepancy between Nomad result and that of Condor. So this is showing a graph of the mean of the number of, on the left is the mean of the best number of constraint violations as the number of function evaluations increase. And the green and the blue are the Condor algorithms. And you can see that it's able to drive the number of constraint violations very quickly to zero compared to the other methods. On the right, it's showing the mean of the best sum of squares of the constraint violations. So in either case, you can see that it's able to find feasible points more quickly. This is showing the number of simulations to feasibility to find a feasible point, and also the first feasible objective value obtained for 10 trials of two-phase Condor. And again, so I did not include, so the Condor algorithms obtain a better feasible SAMFO within a small number of iterations, so roughly about 320 simulations, you're able to find a feasible point on that problem, while neither Nomad nor GA found a feasible point within the equivalent of 10 times D simulations. This is comparing the mean of the best feasible objective value obtained by the different Condor variants. So again, the other results were not included because they were not even able to find a feasible sample point within the limited number of evaluations. And you can see that the results here are very close to one another, with maybe a slight advantage for the mixed version of Condor. So to summarize, this talk presented the surrogate-based two-phase Condor algorithm for constrained discrete black box optimization. It's an extension of Condor that does not require a feasible initial point. For phase one searches for a feasible point, while phase two searches for an optimal solution using surrogates for the objectives and constraints. Two-phase Condor algorithms found feasible points much more quickly and yielded much better feasible objective values than Nomad and GA, given a limited computational budget on in the artificial test problems in the master benchmark. And that's it. Thank you so much for your attention. So are there any questions?
Thank you for your nice presentation. And thank you for your presentation. Actually, you should be in the middle of the night. I don't know.
Yeah, it's about 5:30 in the morning. So
yeah, so thank you.
Okay.
Yeah, thanks a lot for your presentation. So any questions? I have one question or two.
Sure.
You have two versions of Condor. One it's RBF local, and the other is RBF global. What are the differences? And the RBF stands for, I missed that.
Sorry. Oh, what are the differences? So, okay. So the
local. And the RBF stands for, I missed that.
The stands, radial basis function model.
Okay.
Sorry.
My second question was, what type of radial basis function you used?
I'm just using the cubic version. The cubic form, all the other versions are possible. So you could try out those. I think other people have tried different versions, but the cubic has been working very well for many of these test problems that I've worked on, you know, over the years. So, mm-hmm. I mean, the advantage is that it doesn't even have a hyperparameter to estimate. And even with that simplicity, it's able to, I think the idea is just to get a good enough, sort of ability to to generate an improving solution. It's not necessarily always the best, but it's able to, as long as it's able to point in the right direction to have an improvement.
Okay.
I don't know if that, you know, helps. Yeah.
Yes. Well, thank you. It's a very challenging subject, and I think you have done a great job.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
And we have to move to the second presentation, which will be.
I don't know if I can say hello to Ravel.
Oh yes.
Oh hi. Hi. Hi Anna.
Nice to you. Yeah. And thank you for your interesting presentation.
Okay. Thank you so much, Anna. Thank you. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You can go on.
Okay. Moving to the second presentation of this session, and it's going to be presented by Maria Fernanda Costa. Go ahead.
Okay. Good morning. Are you seeing my presentation?
Yes. Not now. Yes.
Okay, can start?
Okay. Whenever you want, go ahead.
Okay, thank you. I will present a cluster algorithm based on fitness probability scores for cluster center optimization. This is a joint work with my colleagues Ana Maria Rocha and Edith Fernandes from the Algorithm Center of University of Minho. This is the outline of my talk. First, I will present a brief introduction and some ideas of clustering. And then I will present the cluster algorithm with the center optimization based on fitness probability scores. Finally, I will show some computational results and conclusion of this work. Clustering consists of grouping a set of data points in a way that the similarity of elements in a group called cluster is maximized, while similarity of elements between different groups are minimized. The aim of this work is to develop a clustering algorithm that dynamically adds, deletes, and merges clusters based on the fitness probability scores of the cluster centers. The main contributions of the work are the algorithm parameters that are dynamically computed and depend on the characteristics of the dataset, and also the only a few of cluster centers are identified as the least fitted centers and undergo to an optimization process. So let X be a data set of endpoints in an eight-dimensional space. A partitioning clustering algorithm tries to find a partition C of K clusters. This partition must satisfy these three properties here. Each cluster should have at least one point. A point should not belong to two different clusters, and each point should belong to a cluster. Since there are a number of ways to partition a data set and maintain these properties, a fitness function should be used so that to evaluate the partitions. Therefore, the clustering algorithm, the clustering problem could be stated as finding an optimal solution C star that gives the optimal adequacy when compared to all the other feasible solutions. So here I'm going to briefly do a description of the cluster algorithm proposed in this work. So at the initial step, a number of the clusters K must be specified, and the corresponding centers are randomly generated in the search region of the data points. Then, iteratively, the algorithm sequentially applies these five processes here. I do a brief description and then I go to in more detail this. So at the first process is the second algorithm. Each point is assigned to a cluster. After this, clusters may be merged and deleted. Then the cluster with maximum hyper volume may be split into new clusters. And then the algorithm checks if the cluster may be merged or deleted. And in the last step, in the last process, a set of the current cluster centers are identified as the least fitted centers and undergo an optimization process. So in more detail, these five processes. So the second algorithm to find which clusters to assign a point. The idea is to find the closest distance from that point to a center, and the point is assigned to that cluster. After this, if no points have been assigned to a cluster, the center will be deleted and the cluster will be removed. So the deleting algorithm is in this algorithm that you can merge and delete clusters. So the two closest clusters to each other are identified, and this cluster may be merged if the distance between their centers is below a threshold value at D. Here, this parameter is dynamically defined and is computed as this. Depends on the current number of the clusters and the minimum amplitude of the search region. Furthermore, if the cluster with the lowest number of the points verify this condition here, this cluster, the points of this cluster are coined as noise, and this cluster is removed and the center is deleted. Again, here this parameter depends on the number of the points of our data set. The separating algorithm. One cluster may be had along of the iterative process by splitting the cluster with the maximum hypervolume if its volume, that is computed as this expression for each cluster, is not smaller than a threshold value at V. Here, this parameter, again, is dynamically defined to be problem-dependent and is given by this expression here, where this vector sigma is computed component-wise as follows. So, after after the closest to be splitted has been identified, its center is modified and a new center is created. The only component that is modifying this center is the component in the index JM, and similarly, the component of the new center that differs from this center here is the component in position JM. These components are computed using this expression here for each of these centers. And this index JM corresponds to the largest component of the vector in the sigma. After this, okay, the points in this cluster are reassigned between these two clusters using the previous algorithm, the assign algorithm. So, to choose the centers to be optimized, a fitness probability score of the center is used. In this, in our case, the FPS score are computed based on the as this, based on the current K cluster centers, and based on this fitness function here, we use this to define the score of each cluster using this formula here. So, the clusters with score greater or equal than a certain value, in this case this value is the average of the scores of the current cluster centers, are considered to have fitter centers and need not to be optimized. Otherwise, these clusters are considered to have least fitted centers and undergo an optimization process. In our case, we use the differential evolution algorithm with this objective function, that is the sum within cluster distance. So the computational result of this work, the algorithms are coded in MATLAB. Four data sets were used to compute and visualize the partitioning clustering, two data sets of points with two attributes, one data set with four attributes, and one data set with 13 attributes. In the differential evolution algorithm runs for 5 iterations. The size and the size of population is 20, and the other parameters of the DA are set as follows. The results of our cluster algorithm that denoted by algorithm 1 are compared by the results produced by kappa-means algorithm and by DBSCAN clustering algorithm. The kappa means algorithms requires to know in advance the optimal number of the clusters k. In our algorithm, at initial step, the number of the clusters is set as follows, which depends on the number of ones of the data set. The DBS scan algorithm depends on these two parameters, being very sensitive to the variation in this parameter epsilon. This epsilon is the neighborhood search radius around each point that is used in this approach. The performance of these algorithms are measured in terms of the Davis-Baldwin index, that is given by the expression here, and the smallest the DB index indicates about optimal partitions. So, sorry, these are the data sets used to test in this work. These two first are randomly generated from a multivariate normal distribution and they have two attributes. And these two here are well-known data sets in the literature, that is the Hirsch data set and the Wein data set. These two data sets have three clusters. This data set one have three clusters and this has two clusters. So here we do the visualization of the results for data set one. At the top here, these three plots correspond to the clustering obtained with our algorithm, with six clustered centers randomly generated at initial iteration, at initial step. Here in this figure here, we show the clustering obtained after the algorithm applied the first four process, assign, delete, split, and delete. And here we show the centers obtained by the first call of the differential evolution algorithm, where the only this center that belongs to the cluster two has been optimized. From iteration two to iteration three, we see that this center of this cluster has been optimized and this algorithm stopped with this solution here. And the DBA index is 0.52. Here are the results with the DBA scan algorithm for two different values of this parameter epsilon. And you can see that this parameter with this value for epsilon considers a large number of points in the data set as noise points. And these are the results with kappa means, okay? Here you need to provide to give to this algorithm the number of the clusters, in this case, three. Here are the results for the problem data set two. This, again, these three plots here shows the cluster obtained with our algorithm with 20 cluster centers randomly generated at initial step. Here we show, you can see that the algorithm only preserves three centers after applying the first four process, assign, delete, split, and delete. And you can see that these three centers are chosen to be optimized by the differential evolution algorithm. And applying again the processes, assign, delete, split, the one of these centers is removed. One of these clusters is removed. And this is the algorithm stop at iteration six with these two clusters. And you can see that this center has been optimized by the optimization algorithm. And again, here are the results produced by the DBS scan algorithm. And here are the results with kappa means. So finally, here we show the results produced by how algorithm and solve the problems, each data set and the Wein data set. We compare our results with the results that are in this paper 10 that use a PSEO approach to the clustering, and 12 that use an enhanced generic algorithm. Our algorithm was run 30 times for each of the data sets. And in this table, we showed the objective function value, WC, the best, the average, and worst over the successful run. So from this table here, you can see that our algorithm was able to find the three clusters in all the runs for the that for the HEADS data set, and finds the three clusters in the 73% of the runs for the WINE data set. The values of the objective function, the objective function values of the best run in our algorithm are the same order of the magnitude of than the other approach. And you can see more, like the variation between the best, the variation and the worst in our algorithm is less than the variation reported in that papers. And this could be explained by the fact that these variations have been specifically designed to and modified to integrate the clustering process. And you can see that unlike to the PSO approach in 10, in this paper, our algorithm not seem to be affected by the dimension of the dataset X as far as computation time is concerned here. So, conclusion of this work, the preliminary numerical experiment shows that this algorithm, the proposed algorithm to select the cluster sensor that should undergo an automation process is effective and robust. The cluster methodology is an iterative process, as I already explained, that relies on five sequentially applied main process, the assign points that, of data set to the current clusters. Cluster may be merged and deleted if the smallest distance between two clusters centered is below a threshold value and the number of points in a cluster is very small. After this, the algorithm split the cluster with maximum hypervolume if its volume exceeds a certain target value. The algorithm checks again if cluster may be merged or deleted. And after this, the algorithm optimizes a set of cluster centers, identifies as least fit the centers using, in our case, the differential evolution algorithm. In future work, we intend to use the data set with non-convex clusters, cluster with different shapes and size will be addressed. And you intend to integrate in this case to treat these problems, a kernel function in the cluster approach. So this is the reference of this work and thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much for your very nice presentation and your nice work. Any questions?
Yes. Can I ask?
Yes.
Okay. Have you compared this method with also standard methods, where also the number of clusters is defined a priori?
We compare this technique as we show here with KP-means and DBSCAN algorithm. KP-means requires to know a priori the number of the clusters. DBSCAN and our algorithm not require this. And you compare also with these two papers, these two approaches that are reporting these two papers, the PSO approach in paper 10 and with this EnhancedNet algorithm in this paper here.
Okay, so
at the moment I don't know if these two approaches require or not the in advance to know a priori the number of the clusters. Okay, I don't remember.
Okay. Well, I was thinking more about optimization using the standard optimization methods for clustering, but yes, okay, thank you.
Okay, in this presentation, you only optimize only some center of certain clusters. Okay, the other are not optimized. I don't know if you understand this, but yes. Some centers are choose to be optimized, and only you apply the optimization process here to optimize these centers based on this the minimum distance based on this. Objective function here, okay? You want to minimize the distance from this point to the air center, to,
yes,
to its center.
Okay, got, yes.
And the other are fixed.
Yes. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Well, thank you. There are no further time for questions. Thanks again. And we need to move on to the third presentation that will be given by Filipe Alves.
Yeah, Professor, I'm here. I will share my presentation. You already see my presentation.
Yes, yeah. If you could please put it in a presentation mode. Yes, perfect.
It's okay. Okay, I can start?
Yes.
Okay. So my name is Filipe Alves, and I'm a PhD student from University of Minho, and today I will present my work about solving a logistics system for vehicle routing problem using an open source tool. So the agenda for these presentations, I will start with a brief introduction, the main motivation and the goals, my system architecture, some ideas about BRP formulation, the open source solver, some computational experiments, and I will finish with the main conclusions and future work. So, as you know, in shared service logistics, solutions for routing problems need to be more efficient, less complex, and with optimization, especially by the growing demand. So for that reason, problems such as the TSP vehicle routing problem have been widely studied in operation research. And as you know, any transportation scaling process involves the optimal location, the routing, and also the tasks planning across the resource. And VRP problem normally involve combinatorial optimization and integer programming to organize the routes. We need also to satisfy the constraints, requirements, and also minimize the overall transport cost, for example, the distance, the time, and so on. And today, as you know, BRP considers some factors that can affect it. For example, the capacity of the vehicles, the number of depots, the traffic conditions, time windows, and so on. And normally, these factors makes route optimization difficult in reasonable time. For that reason, are called NPR problems. The main motivations was, we know that new technologies and tools combine optimization techniques, for example, using heuristics, meta-heuristics, and also combine with solutions to support decision-making in operational logistics. But most computational solutions require high computational effort, are commercial with closed code and also with subscription fees. And for that reason, Google OR Tools is open source with active and recent community, are free, powerful, and customizable, specially dedicated to this topic, operational research. And for that reason, the main goals we defined in first to develop an application based on Google OR Tools, combined also with online and external service integrations, for example, Google Maps, Google Distance Matrix, and so on, to solve a VRP problem. And the other goal is to perform experimental tests in simulated instance of a VRP in the district of Porto in Portugal. Related to our system architecture, the idea is develop an innovative application based on a robust systems for digitalize the data. We try to manipulate also the data and integrate the use of Google OR tools, and also use optimization algorithms and external services. These systems will rely on backend models with the data and the resource, a database to serve as an engine, and external services like Google OR tools, distance matrix, and the VRP algorithm. The structure of the systems as a cloud architecture, if I can say that, to facilitate the interaction between the models. On the other hand, we have developed a dashboard to make the routine assess and monitoring the data and get also the VRP solutions. Our idea in the VRP formulations is to solve the logistics systems using a well-known algorithm that are integrated in Google OR tools. And our scenario is first, distribute several points that are the locations in a area. And each one of them requires, for example, a type of task or services. Also, the logistic providers has a fleet of homogeneous vehicles in its depot. The idea is to ensure the equity of services, get balanced routes, and minimize the maximum route, considering as objective function the time or the distance. The objective functions could be based, as I said before, in minimizing the maximum distance, the first equation, or the maximum time, the second one. And the idea here is empower the user preference, because we can make, for example, if the user is, wants to minimize the distance, can select that equation. Also, of course, some assumptions and constraints will be considered to guarantee the proper flow of the vehicles. Going deeper into the open source solver, this tool is developed and updated by Google, being fast and the portable software suite for solving complex and combinatorial optimization problems. Their library presents high trust programming environment and are really nice and really easy to use in different programming language. The recent activity and community that uses the tools presents criteria such as the vehicle routing and integer, linear and constraint programming. They present some flexibility in the algorithm choice and modifications. For example, we can pass from heuristics to meta-heuristics. There are really, really easy to declarations of soft or specific restrictions. And also, the people say that we get good quality of the produced solutions. We can integrate also skills with online systems or services, in that case, Google Maps, Google Matrix API, and so on, and also present testing tools with abilities to deal with different formats, for example, CSV, JSON, and so on. Also, I think that is interesting to understand the steps of our procedures. For example, how we can input the data, how we can execute the model and get the solutions like presented in the image. So the app starts, we perform the setup of the customers, the locations and the respective number of the vehicles. In turn, we need also to compute the indices that are generated through the external services, and the objectives need to be headed. And the search limits and resolution strategies need to be also defined. After the ideal solutions is found, the procedure is finished, and we can present the solutions through our routing or in a map. Sometimes better solutions can be found by changing the search options in the solver, for example, changing between heuristics, changing to meta-heuristics, and vice versa. And the Google operational research is very promising and allows to the applications in many different VRP problems or scheduling problems. In terms of computational experiments and speaking in the first phase in data collection, the idea is to allocate different locations, and the depot is in the district of Porto in Portugal, but this is a case, just an example, because we can replicate in other cities. The data are dynamically instantiated in a time and distance matrix for combinatorial calculation. In that case, we are using the Google Maps and Google Matrix. The tests, we use three different instances that was generated to generate the robustness of the tool, to test the tool, like present on the table. And the idea here is to perform a small sensitivity analysis considering different optimization strategies and also different instances. After creating the data set, defining the constraints, it is important to choose the main strategies to treat the result as final solution. So, therefore, unit tests was developed for both that input and solution output, and also to test the different strategies. First, it is important to define the search limits. For example, we can select the maximum length of time, the number of solutions found. We can change these values. Second, we need to address the first solution strategies, namely heuristics. We realize tests with 6 of the 13 methods existing. For example, we select the savings and Christofides algorithms. In turn, the user can also select, if they want, local search algorithms, namely meta-heuristics or called by Google meta-heuristics. Normally provide theoretically better results, but here we realize tests with 3 of the 6 methods available. We select, for example, simulated annealing and taboo search method. In last, the user can configure some parameters to generate different outputs, for example, the runtime, the maximum time, and the number of vehicles used. And the setting of these different parameters and options will generate different outputs. And here we can try to get better sensitive analysis. Related to our results, the first layer of tests using only heuristics generated optimal routes and minimized the length of the longest route between the vehicles. Here we just defined to minimize the time. The graph shows on the x-axis the different strategies grouped by the 3 cases, and the other presents the results of each of the strategy in order to the route time. It is possible to verify that the runtime increase as long as the complexity of the instance are increased, as expected. In addition, the best insertion heuristic was not able to solve any case problem. Also, there was a slight increase in terms of the route time solution, especially for the case 3. The second layer of tests using the meta-heuristics, the local search strategies. On the image, the left vertical axis are related to the routing time, while the values on the right axis refer to the runtime. The results are consistent when compared to the previous ones, but obtained better solutions for case 2 and case 3 in terms of route time. Also, OrTools allows to specify a runtime limit when you are using meta-heuristics, increasing the chance to find better solutions. In general, the method guided local search presents the best results, especially for the case 2. As an example, it's possible to suggest that this method, guided local search, is the best choice because due to better performance in case 2, and these solutions are presented on the table related to their allocation and scheduling, where the location 0 it represents the depot. After the result, it is available for the user to view the VRP solution and assess, track, and monitor the coordinates of the route using the Google Maps services, and we can customize the real-time information and the next place to visit. In terms of main conclusions, we think that this work showed some extreme usefulness of a recent and popular open-source optimization tool for solving this type of problems. It allows also optimization toolkit get optimized solutions and with our system to digitalize the information in a user-friendly way. With the developed experimental instance revealed balanced solutions, very good runtime and quantitative and qualitative performance to adopt in other VRP variants or problems. The system also presents the possibility of different configurations and optimization strategies, and also present many flexibility in Google service integration, because here we can integrate maps, matrix, the OR tools, and also we can get more systems. In the future, our idea is apply these systems in VRP situations, in real VRP simulation situations, and maybe address optimization strategies with artificial intelligence to get distributed or more reactive solutions in real time. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Philippe, for your very nice work and presentation. We are a little bit behind time, so we don't have time for questions, but if you want, you can pose questions in the chat. It was very nice to learn that Google offers Google OR tools. I don't know if all except me weren't aware of that, but it's something to explore. Thank you. We move to the last presentation, and the presentation is going to be delivered, I think, by Anna Antunes. Go ahead.
Hello, everyone. My name is Anna, and I'm going to talk about feature selection optimization of risk factors for coronary heart disease. And this work was made by me, Lino, Ana Rocha, and Ana Cristina Braga. In this presentation, I will start with an introduction and present the main objectives for this work. After that, a dataset characterization, feature selection, procedures, and implementation results will be discussed. After that, the single and multi-objective optimization results will be presented. And finally, the main conclusions will be identified. According to the World Health Organization, cardiovascular diseases are the main cause of mortality in the world, and it is expected to be the most important cause of death by 2030, where coronary heart disease leads to a heart attack, which occurs when the blood flow to the heart is cut off, and there is a decrease in the supply of oxygen and nutrients. Thus, in Portugal, has presented a low risk of coronary heart disease for decades, but in 2013, it was the second most common cause of death. So how can you prevent these heart attacks? After this knowledge, it is important to prevent this type of disease and identify which combination of variables can predict wherever the patient is at risk for future coronary heart disease. Thus, this work intended to use feature selection to identify the best subset of variables to take in consideration, where machine learning techniques were used to classify the risk of coronary heart disease, and it was considered single and multi-objective optimization, since in this type of analysis, it is important to evaluate different metrics. So the data set used in this work was a fragment data available in Kaggle repository. This data has 16 variables divided into demographic. This is gender, age, and education level. We have also behavior variables, that is current smoker and number of cigarettes per day, and medical variables that are blood pressure medication, head or stroke, hypertensive, diabetes, total cholesterol level, systolic and diastolic blood pressure, body max index, heart rate, glucose level, and if has risk of coronary heart disease. Using the bar plot for the risk of coronary heart disease, it is possible to see that there is more information when the patient does not have risk of coronary heart disease. Therefore, to achieve the goal of the work, it was defined the stats, where the data was divided into training and testing set using 80 and 20% respectively. It was used also the wrapper method for the feature selection, and the feed for neural network was the machine learning technique used. Finally, the single and multi-objective optimization must be performed considering genetic algorithm to minimize type 2 error and to maximize accuracy. The feature selection approach was implemented in MATLAB using the global optimization and statistic and machine learning toolboxes. For the feed-forward neural network, it was defined three different structures. The first one is composed with one hidden layer with 8 neurons, the second one with 2 hidden layers with 8 and 4 neurons, and the last one with 3 hidden layers with 8, 4, and 2 neurons. The number of epochs was set as 750, and the training set ratio was defined as 1 and the validation and testing set to 0 to maintain the same training set during the optimization process and to determine the performance measures. Moreover, the population size for the genetic algorithm was defined as 100 and considered the depth of feasible mutation. Here we use two different neural networks to see how different the results will be. In a first instance, the single objective optimization was performed to minimize type 2 error and accuracy individual with a true neural network structure. Thus, when the goal is to minimize the type 2 error, we can see the best result appears in the third neural network with 78.90, and there are 11 variables selected. In terms of accuracy, the last two neural networks obtained the same results, and it was only selected four variables, where the accuracy is equal to 85.64. Note that type 2 error considers more variables to predict the risk of coronary heart disease than accuracy. Besides that, we know that the type 2 error values are too high, which may be related to the sample size that is not balanced. For the type 2 error, the variables to take in consideration are gender, age, education level, current smoke cigarettes per day, hypertension, diabetes, systolic and diastolic blood pressure, body mass index, and glucose level. For accuracy, is blood pressure, medication, head or stroke, hypertensive, and diabetes. After the analysis of these results, the third neural network was used in the multi-objective optimization, since it obtained the best results. So here, the multi-objective optimization was performed to minimize type 2 error and maximize accuracy at the same time. Here we have seven non-dominated solutions for the neural network with the three hidden layers with 8, 4, and 2 neurons. It can be concluded that when the type 2 error increased, the accuracy value also increased in the most cases. The best values for type 2 error and accuracy were 65.14 and 86.46, respectively. The best solutions depends on wherever the decision maker gives more importance to accuracy or type 2 error. In terms of variables, current smoker, blood pressure, medication, and body mass index do not appear in any solution, and in contrast, gender, age, systolic blood pressure, and glucose level appears in all of them. So this is the main variables to take in consideration. And in addition, the solutions 1 and 4 have the same variables, but the criteria values are different, since the neural network weights are optimized in each solution, and this can be the reason for these results. In terms of conclusions, one interesting remark is that type 2 error considers more variables than accuracy. The lowest and highest value for type 2 error and accuracy was 78.90 and 85.64, respectively. Also, risk factor, gender, age, education level, current smoker, cigarettes per day, hypertension, diabetes, systolic and diastolic pressure, body mass index, and glucose level must be considered when the criterion is to minimize the type 2 error. Although the subset of variables blood pressure, medication, head or stroke, hypertension, and diabetes must be considered when the criterion is to maximize accuracy. In terms of multi-objective optimization, it was found 7 non-dominated solutions where gender, age, systolic blood pressure, and glucose level variables belong to all of them. So these are also the main variables to take in consideration to prevent the risk of coronary heart disease. So this is the reference I use in this presentation. This is our acknowledgements. This work has been supported by FCT. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much for your very nice presentation and work. Any questions? I don't see any questions. I have a question. Is it possible for you to test your results that use data from the Framingham study that is widely used in health using, for instance, a small subset of data from Portuguese data?
Yes, we don't have access of this information for Portuguese people, so you didn't use that, but it's important, and I think it will be, if you have the data available, it will be good for us to test.
Okay, Eligius is not going to provide this data. Well, if we don't have any further questions, this ends this third session of computational optimization and applications. And now we have a break for lunch or breakfast in case of Roma. And hopefully we all can be back in the afternoon. See you later.
See you.
Thank you very much.
See you.
Thank you.
See you.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. See you later.
Adios.